is your third project together, the third time you've collaborated, and it's your third feature. Can you talk a bit about the inspiration behind this particular project and maybe just what it was like to work together and how it all came about?
I mean, this film raises a lot of questions and how you should live your life and how to deal with things like freedom and responsibility. And these are questions that I've been working with all my films in different ways. And something that me and Alicia have always been interested in, and the roles that I've been reading has this struggles. And I think for me as a director, it's been such a gift that you could have these conversations with an actor and develop together and be braver and go farther.
For me, I was thrilled to get the chance to work with Lisa again. It was probably 9 years ago. I was 20. I hadn't done a feature film yet, and I had someone who presented not only a story but a character. Back then, that was extremely daring. She is not afraid of exploring subjects or people that show very complex and multi-leveled emotions within themselves. You often become very close to those characters, and even though I find them all very strong and colorful and brave and quite beautiful, she's daring in the sense that the characters that I played have been able to show extreme kind of they've been emotionally ugly in the sense that I've been exploring real humane people and shown all aspects and all colors of these roles. And when I got the chance to hear that Lisa was working on his third script and that she was planning on making it back home in Sweden, I was thrilled to hear that she was back on it again. And I'm thrilled to be here today, and that Lisa was able to be convinced, since I really thought that this film had the potential of reaching out to a more international audience and be made in the English language. And Lisa has been a great inspiration for me and been, you know, part of introducing me to the world of cinema. So I'm really happy to be with her tonight.
You talk a little bit about the complexity and at times maybe the ugliness of her character, but eventually in her arc she grows to some form of acceptance of her sister's decision. I'm wondering how you prepared for that and if you met with people that were suffering from terminal illnesses or what sort of work you did to get there.
Me included, I think it's a very universal thing. I think most people, at least at a certain age, have been close to somebody or someone, maybe a friend or family, who are dealing with what it is to be facing death. And I think illness and death is something that we all can relate to. But this film is not, you know, that's not what it is about. It's really about life and how you, in the end, maybe fight to have the choice of actually being able not only to have how you live your life, but also how you decide to end your life. And the relationship between the sisters was probably what drew me the most to this project. I think it's very interesting, that thing about how you are brought in up into a family, how you maybe feel obliged to have a relationship because you are born into the same family, and it's a tough thing, that thing of maybe two people growing up and being very different and taking very different decisions in life and being very different personalities and trying to find a way and a level of where you hopefully connect and find a way for acceptance and love between one another, and much due to the history that you've actually shared, all the years that maybe a lot of other people surrounding you haven't seen. So that sister relationship to me was really drew me probably the most to this project.
I did some research in the beginning when I was working with the script in the early stage, but for me, I realized the more research I did around the subject, I didn't want it to become, you know, a film like a debate for and against, because if I wanted that, I could write an article in a newspaper or get into some of these organizations that, you know, are against or for. So for me, it was important to leave that perspective and go into the story about the sisters.
Interesting. I sat now in the audience and again watched the film, and the last scene is quite a long one and a very strong one. I find the last moments of before Ines dies, and it was a very interesting point in our research when we actually got the chance to see. It's a lot of these clinics that. And it's been documentaries, so you can go online and on YouTube and watch actually just these moments on YouTube. And what kind of threw me was that it's interesting how death is just one moment to another, and then it's gone. And the kind of, it was almost, you know, clinical, and of course there was a few different people that we saw in these documentaries, but all of them were extremely just quite calm and quite structured, and in the way that it's explained here. I mean, people really do say those last things that the nurse says is actually what is normally the procedure and actually how it works at these clinics, and I had no idea. Before I stepped into this film, that was the reality, and that's the case.
You both talk about the importance of showing so much life in the film, even though you're dealing with the subject of death. And I think one of the other things that has so much life in it is the location. It's beautiful and idyllic, and I'm wondering if you can talk a bit about the decision to shoot where you did and how that played into the story.
Yeah, for me, it was really important to shoot this film in a nature that was growing, that was so much alive, that because I for me, the contrast visually between the nature that want to survive in any sense and just growing and being beautiful in itself, and the nature doesn't care about us or this destinies, and so it has its own power, and to this place where the nature want to grow, people come to choose to die, and it was something in this contrast that really interested me.
You talked a lot about the relationship with your sister in the film, played by Eva Green, and I think one of the things that's so good about the way that relationship is portrayed is that there's so much baggage and weight that comes to your relationship on screen that we don't see. So I'm wondering how you went about working with Eva and how you guys prepared for that. Did you spend a lot of time together, no time together? How did you create that dynamic on screen?
Yes, we had a certain amount of time to have rehearsals. Normally, film we don't have too much, but we spent a lot of the time discussing, their background stories. So already in like the first scene when they meet at the airport, they should hopefully be able to read off a lot of clues between them. And I think that's normally the case with family members. You have so much history, so sometimes you can sit in the same room and you don't have to say much, and still you have a conversation, and you can even both treat each other well, have a good time, or you can, without words, having a fight, because you know exactly what triggers to pull or how to pique the other person, and was really something that we wanted to work with and make sure that was on screen.
I think what was such a gift as a director was that I think, I mean, Alicia and Eva are such amazing actresses, both of them, but they are very different. And I think it was important as a director to respect this. And also, I think it was something that we could use in the work and also on screen, that you really could use the differences in their work and also in your personality, I think.
Okay, we can turn it over to you guys for some questions, if there are any questions in the audience. Yes, just down here in the red, yeah. The question was a compliment to Ava's performance as well, and just wondering how you went about finding her and really getting her talent to shine through. And I think to that I would maybe add how you went about finding and working with Charlotte Rampling, who is also incredible in the film.
Yeah, it was discussion, you know, that probably was one of the first ones. Because the sister relationship is kind of the core of the film, and Ava was on our wish list from the beginning, I think, and it felt like it was a very, both, you know, like you said, obvious dynamic between me too. I'm a big fan of Ava. Also, you know, she's done a lot of she has that strength within her, and a lot of roles that she plays, it's very kind of extrovert. But I've always been, you know, so curious because she has so much going on, you know, in the back of our, you know, behind her eyes, and I really thought that kind of strength that I really think that Ines has within was something that would be, you know, perfectly fitted for someone like Ava.
Yeah, and I think Eva also was longing for another kind of role and another, you know, opportunity to show what she can do. So Eva was, I mean, as soon as she's read the script, she was kind of on. It was pretty clear. Charlotte was a harder cookie. I really had to, you know, convince her. I had to go to Paris, I had to go to London, I had to, you know, really. She's such a wonderful lady, and we had wonderful discussions.
Mm. Okay, yes, just in the middle here. You're good.
Do you think both of these actresses could have played both of these roles?
Yeah. Do you think that you could, maybe this is a question for both of you, do you think that Alicia and Ava could have swapped roles and played the other part?
I mean, if you're such a good actress, I think it will absolutely be possible. You couldn't say it's not possible. I would like to see that film. But I think when we casted it this way and during the discussions, it was obvious that the casting that we did felt very natural.
Mm. It is interesting. I think it's one of the, maybe, you know, it's filmmaking is a lot of different sections. Writing the script is almost its own film to get that done. Then you start to actually go and shoot the film. And then I think casting is one of the first things that you go through. And I think it's always interesting to know that it's magic what happens the first day on set. You can have had rehearsals, of course, but you know, actors, we're at home and we think a lot and we're really nervous. We come the first day and think, oh, now they're finally going to see all these things that I've been thinking about at home, and I hope it's going to, you know, come out in somewhat of a good way. And the dynamic between people is always what's going to set the tone of how a film is going to become. So it's the dynamic and it's, if it works, it's always interesting. So it would just have been a very, you know, it would have been a different film, but yeah.
Okay, we have time for a couple more. I want to get to somebody on the balcony if there is anybody up there. Okay, I hear you. Can you wave your hand? Okay, got it. Okay. To the gentleman closer to the front. Did everybody get that one? No? Okay. So the question is about, so Charlotte Rampling's character in the film espouses the principles of freedom and autonomy as sort of the highest principles one can try to live by. But then she locks Inez in a room. Can you talk a little bit about that decision in the writing?
Yeah, sure. To me, Charlotte's character is an anarchist. She does whatever she wants to, basically. And I wouldn't say that she, you know, she's not moral in that kind of sense that she kind of stick to, she's an anarchist in a good and a bad way, or whatever you want to call it. I think she's free. And if she feels that she want to lock someone in, she does that. So she works on intuition.
Okay, we have time for one final question. I'm going to go towards the back here on the aisle. Yeah, go ahead.
So you mentioned that you did some research about the facilities that have assisted suicide. We're just wondering how much of your research did you then incorporate in the film versus how much of the way these clinics operate did you make from fiction?
So you mentioned researching some facilities that facilitate assisted suicide, and how much of that research sort of landed up in the film in the end, and how much was sort of your own interpretation or your own vision of what would happen?
Wow, that's a big one. I think, for me, authenticity was the importance for the story in emotional way. And Alicia just said, the ending part where is that's how it goes and that's how it works. This clinics, if you mean the organization, if it's there is this clinics in the world, and it's a little bit different in different countries, but this in that time of sense. I would say that this clinic leaves reality a little bit. So this is an emotional journey that the sister is going through, and this was also something that really, you know, I always loved film that trying to find their own way through the story and not sticking to a specific genre or specific way to do things, so it's a little bit of artistic freedom in how to create this place. Yes.
Yeah, I think, we incorporated the fact that you see these sisters arrive in Europe and how they travel towards the mountain, and you can assume that it might be Switzerland that they're in, and I think it was just important to kind of set the tone of where they are, that this place could exist. And then, of course, the way that they check in and the fact that, you know, there's certain rules of how you do these things. And that is what it is in reality. And then, of course, maybe this place doesn't exist, but I think it would want to be the fantasy if someone decided that this is a place where we, let people indulge themselves in whatever wishes they have. Over the last few days, then it could take this twist to it, and then we wanted to fold it all together in the end by having a scene that was very authentic to the research that we had done, because it's almost that expectation leading up, and all these emotions that are within everybody of fearing or wondering what is death and what is after it. it's really just that. And that was one of the things that really stuck with me, that it's the expectations and the emotions leading up to it. And it was every footage that I saw, I was just surprised by the, of course, absolute nothingness, you know, that enters the room and the space afterwards. So I love the fact that she has the strength of journey and, you know, wanting to take us on a journey that both incorporates fantasy and reality.
Well, thank you so much for sharing this journey with us tonight.